Well, Merry Christmas, everyone. It is just great to have you here to sing praises to our God and just to celebrate the birth of Jesus. Let's all stand and we'll all lift our voices together and sing his praises. This Christmas Eve to sing praises to our God, to join together, to celebrate this season. My name is Steve Goldberg. I'm the worship director here, and I welcome you. If you're a guest with us, we have a communication card on the backside of the bulletin that you received on your way in today. Fill that out and drop that in the offering basket and let that be your gift to us today. We have a lot of stuff going on in the life of the church. You can find it out at parkridgechurch.com. But right now, I'm going to ask that you say hello to one another, and when you do, if there are empty seats between you, if you guys would just move to the center of your sections, that would be awesome. We have some more people coming in. So go ahead and greet one another. If you would, please join me as we pray for our offering this evening. Dear Heavenly Father, you are so good. You are so good to us. And Lord, we sing your praises, not for what you've done in our lives, Lord, but for who you are, creator of the universe, the beginning, the end, the Alpha, the Omega. And Lord, the fact that you have provided a way through your son, Jesus, is just beyond words. So, Lord, we pray that we give today with joyful hearts, knowing that you don't need our money, Lord, but you call us to give out of obedience and with joy. So, Lord, we ask that you multiply what's given in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you. dear Heavenly Father, the great I am. You are sovereign, you are in charge, and you brought every single person that is in this room here for a reason, Lord. We don't take that for granted. We thank you so very much for bringing us here to celebrate the birth of Jesus. We thank you for entrusting Mary and Joseph to be his earthly parents. We know that you are his heavenly father, his good, good father, and you are our heavenly father, our good, good father. So we thank you so very much for all that you have done in our lives and all that you are going to do in our lives. Right now, we ask that you would be with us during this message, that you would open our hearts and our ears to hear from you through Pastor Eddie, but directly from your word. Lord, we put all of our moments in your hands. We pray all of this in Jesus, that little infant baby, in his name. Amen.
Amen. Wow. I guess the 4 o'clock service is going to be okay for us to go ahead and choose an early time to have our first service. We have 4 services this weekend, and you are the inaugural service for the weekend. Thank you so much for being here. I hope that already you have been experiencing joy in your Christmas season. The kids are out of school now. You're probably off work today at least, most of you, and maybe tomorrow as well. So enjoy the break that you have. You know, Christmas is a wonderful season because it reminds us of one of the most significant things theologically we can ever know, and that is that God came to earth. I shared this past Sunday, and I really do believe it to be true, that Jesus coming to earth is the greatest mission trip ever undertaken. You know, God left heaven for a very specific purpose, that we might be made right with him. And you know, that's no easy task, because we're in a bad way and we're in great need of a Savior. So we're so glad that you're here to worship with us this afternoon. I heard from some of our staff that there's so many of you here. We're actually setting up some overflow outside and trying to make it work. So again, thank you for being here and for squeezing in tight to make everyone fit. If you are a guest with us, my name is Eddie Bevel. I'm one of the pastors here. It's been my joy and privilege to serve on staff here since the beginning of our church in 1992, back in the days when we just met in the public high school, had no land, no building, no anything, and I had black hair. So it's been a long time since we've been doing this. And who would have thought in those early days that this many people would have come? You know, 4 services are required that we be able to accommodate everyone this weekend, and we regularly have 3 services, and maybe many of you were able to attend the Joy concert that we had earlier in the month where we were at the Coral Springs Center for the Performing Arts. It was just great to be able to celebrate and worship there as well in a different way. Today we're actually going to look at 3 different passages of Scripture. And we're certainly going to look at the classic passage of Scripture, most would say, Luke chapter 2. If you have your Bibles, you can go ahead and find Luke chapter 2. But we're also going to look at 2 other passages, because I want to highlight 3 seminal events in the life of Jesus. Certainly his birth, the reason for our celebration of Christmas. But I also want to look at 2 other events, which you'll see. Now, I've chosen these texts because they're all from the same human author, Luke. And you may not know this, many of you do, but some of you may not. Luke is actually the most prolific writer of the New Testament. The Apostle Paul wrote more letters, but Luke actually wrote more words. We have the book of Luke, and we also have the book of Acts. He wrote both of those under the direction of God. And so we're going to look at passages in both of those great books. But we'll begin with Luke chapter 2, and we'll look at verses 1 through 20, because that is the most oft recited story of Christmas, where we celebrate the coming of the Christ child. In those days, a decree went out from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be registered or taxed. This was the first registration when Quirinius was governor of Syria, and all went to be registered, each to his own town. Joseph also went up from Galilee, from the town of Nazareth to Judea, to the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and lineage of David, to be registered with Mary, his betrothed, who was with child. And while they were there, the time came for her to give birth, and she gave birth to her firstborn son, wrapped him in swaddling cloths, laid him in a manger because there was no room for them in the inn. In the same region, there were shepherds out in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night, and an angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were filled with great fear. And the angel said to them, "Fear not, for behold, I bring you good news of a great joy that will be for all the people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. And this will be a sign for you. You will find a baby wrapped in swaddling cloths and lying in a manger." And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace among those with whom he is pleased." When the angels went away from them into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let us go over to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has made known to us." And they went with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the baby lying in a manger. When they saw it, they made known the saying that had been told them concerning this child, and all who heard it wondered at what the shepherds told them. But Mary treasured up all these things, pondering them in her heart. And the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and seen as it had been told them. I want to begin with sharing three great moments that we see in Scripture in regard to Jesus and the significance of his life. Of course, there are many, many more great moments we could share, but just these three this afternoon. First, and what we've read about here, the birth of Jesus. For man, the understanding is a child is born. But for the angels who were celebrating and singing and shouting to the shepherds, this is the Word becoming flesh. And there was more going on than appeared on the surface. Much more going on than appeared on the surface. And we need to understand that as we move into a deeper understanding of the birth. But that's not the only great moment in Jesus' life. I want us to look now at Luke chapter 24. So you can make your way over in the same book, the book of Luke, to the end, chapter 24. And in 24, verses 50 to 53, it's right at the end of his letter, his book, The Ascension. "Then he led them out as far as Bethany, and lifting up his hands, he blessed them. While he blessed them, he parted from them, was carried up into heaven. And they worshipped him and returned to Jerusalem with great joy and were continually in the temple blessing God." So we've seen the very beginning of his life. Now we see the ending of his earthly existence. He's no longer on earth at this point. He's very much alive, but he's not on earth because he ascends, the Bible teaches, to heaven. And so that's the second great moment that we see here is the ascension from manger to mountain. What began at Bethlehem continued at the Mount of Olives, which sits between Jerusalem and Bethany. Now, it's interesting, if you know your geography, you have the city of Jerusalem, you have the city of Bethany, a very small city, and in between, dividing the two, is the Mount of Olives. And from the Mount of Olives, on the facing side, facing toward the west, you see the city of Jerusalem. It's the iconic picture that most of you have seen if you've seen current-day Jerusalem, modern-day Jerusalem, and you see the Gold Dome and you see all the activity. That photograph is typically taken from atop the Mount of Olives. So that gives you an understanding of where Jesus would have been when the ascension took place and he went back to be with the Father. But just over the Mount of Olives, on the backside, is the city of Bethany. Now, Bethany is significant. Jesus had great friends who lived in Bethany, two sisters. Anyone remember their names? Yeah, and they had a brother. What was the brother's name? Lazarus. Isn't that interesting? Lazarus is the one that Jesus, of course, empowered to rise from the grave. The story goes that he called him by name, "Lazarus, come forth," because had he not used his name, every dead person would have come forth. So he specified, "Only Lazarus, come forth." And it was there in that very area, not much more than a stone's throw, both from the city of Jerusalem and the city of Bethany on the Mount of Olives, that Jesus chose, at the bidding of the Father, to ascend to heaven. And then in an interesting way, he did not vaporize. If you're familiar with Star Trek, you know, in the Star Trek shows where they materialize in one place and then they vanish and they materialize in another place. No, that's not the picture that we see here. He was not beamed up. It indicates that he rose up in bodily form with hands outstretched, arms outstretched. I believe that's very significant, again, from a theological perspective, because it gives us an understanding of the humanity of Christ. When Jesus came to earth and took the form of a man by way of the baby Jesus, God is 100% God and 100% man. Now, we would be okay if he rose to heaven and was just God again, but that's not how he rose to heaven. He rose to heaven in bodily form. The significance is that he is, as other passages tell us in the Bible, he is now at the right hand of the Father, and his human form, his glorified body, the body he got after the resurrection, don't fully understand that. Some could recognize him, some could not recognize him until he spoke. Others, like Thomas, wouldn't even recognize him until they saw the wounds. They wanted to see the pierced side and the scars on the hands and feet. But he was a body, real. He ate food. Over 500 people saw him. And in that body, that glorified body, different somehow but the same somehow, he ascended to heaven in bodily form as a man. So it's important because he came as a man. He endured all of the stuff that we endure on earth, and now he has ascended and is at the right hand of the Father in that similar form, bidding on our behalf, working on our behalf, serving on our behalf, the Bible teaches, which leads to the last great event that I want us to see, and that's found in the book of Acts, this last of the three great moments, the book of Acts, the first chapter, verses 6 through 11. So, when they had come together, they asked him, Lord, will you at this time restore the kingdom to Israel? Now, this is taking place after the resurrection of Jesus from the dead, but before the ascension. And he said to them, it is not for you to know times or seasons that the Father has fixed by his own authority, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, to the end of the earth. And when he had said these things, as they were looking on, he was lifted up, and a cloud took him out of their sight. So this is the same experience that's happening in the previous passage, Luke 24, but here Luke is giving a little more detail. He's giving us Jesus' words. And then while they were gazing into heaven as he went, behold, two men stood by them in white robes and said, Men of Galilee, why do you stand looking into heaven? This Jesus, who was taken up from you into heaven, will come in the same way as you saw him go into heaven. So we have a past event, Jesus was the birth. We have a present and continuing event, Jesus is the ascension, the bodily form of Jesus going back up to heaven where he came from. And now we have this future event, the return, the second coming of Christ. And here these presumably angels, these men standing next to him, they have announced he will return in the same way that you have seen him go, come back in this bodily form as a man, but as God. And so he will come back. He has gone to rest. He has gone to reign. He has gone to work. He has gone to intercede. He has gone, as it says in Scripture, to prepare a place for us, that when I return, I will receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also. That's the teaching and the understanding of what is taking place now. He intercedes for us with groanings that are too deep for words, it tells us in Romans. And so we have this picture of Christ working at the right hand of the Father. Father, Son, Holy Spirit. But I want us to see the three phases of activity, There's the incarnation, the manifestation of perfect manhood. That's Jesus. He puts skin on. I always, when I'm speaking with children about the incarnation, because that's a big theological word, incarnation, I always think of the idea of chili con carne, chili with meat. And that's what God did. God put meat on, carne. He put flesh on. That's the incarnation. God with skin. God in personal form. And we have then the clear understanding of the sacrifice on the cross, because it was the person of Christ, the flesh of Christ that was crucified, executed on the cross. And it's everything of Christianity is centered around what took place on the cross. In fact, if you adhere to some kind of so-called form of Christianity that does not centralize the cross, it is not Christian. There is no understanding of Christianity apart from the crucified Christ, because it is there that our sins are atoned for. It is there that the debt is paid that we must come to understand. So there is the incarnation. Then we have what I'm referring to as the eternity. It's a little awkward wording, but the eternity, what I mean by that is the permanence of his eternal humanity. He came as a man. He remains as a man, we believe, for all of eternity now. He ascended as a man and remains a man at God's right hand. He is the true Son of Man. So there we have the eternity. And then last, we see again from Acts chapter 6, the reign, R-E-I-G-N. He will return as King and Redeemer of the world. And this return will inaugurate the great judgment and the great and final redemption. You know, the Bible teaches that one day Christ will return. We don't know exactly what that's going to look like, but we know it will happen based on Scripture. And when he does, he will reign literally, physically, really. And that reign will be so prominent. His royal place will be so prominent over us. The Bible teaches that every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that Jesus is Lord to the glory of God. There will be no exceptions to that. Not all who kneel at that point will have been prior adherents to the truth of Christ, but they will all become believers at that point. Involuntary response. And at that point, the great judgment of God will happen. In fact, in Scripture, it is often referred to as the day, capital D. It's shorthand for the day of judgment, the day of Christ's return, the day of the consummation of the age when all things will be made right. But right now, everything is wrong, broken, sinful, dysfunctional. The very existence of all the troubles of our world is a direct result of the sinfulness of humanity. And even so much as the disease we have, the dysfunction we have, the terrorism we have, the brokenness of our culture, everything is a result of sin. And the Bible teaches that all of us have it. It is a terminal disease. For the wages of sin is death. But, and here's the good news, that's the bad news. The good news is, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ. And so the good news is that through this baby who came, we celebrate Christmas, the crucifixion happened, the sacrifice was paid, the debt was paid, so that we now can have eternity. And we recognize when he returns, he will know us. Why will he know us? He will know us, those of us who have received him, because we have received the blood and we have been, according to the Bible, cleansed by his blood. Because sacrifice is always the plan that God has for sin being paid for. Now, most people don't believe what I've just been saying. Most people on the planet would say, no. That's crazy. How could it be that narrow? You mean only the people who believe that will live forever? According to Scripture, that is true. So the challenge for us becomes, what will we believe? We will all believe something. Will we believe that Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life, or not? Which really leads to three responses that we have. Three responses. Number one, there is the following. If Christ is the way, the truth, and the life, then follow him. If he's not, then don't. Christ has done all that is needed for our salvation. All. Now, that's difficult for us to grasp because humanity by its nature, and maybe especially Western humanity by its nature, wants to do something to be made right with God or wants to do something to better themselves. Maybe I can get more education. Maybe I can work harder. Maybe I can be kinder. I'll do better today than I did yesterday. And there's nothing necessarily wrong with that except that those things don't make us right for eternity. It's a works mentality that I can do enough to be right with God, or I can do enough to be seen as more positive than more negative. It's almost like we have in our head these scales, and we view it as, I hope when I die, the good scale will be heavier than the bad scale. And as long as the good scale is heavier than the bad scale, we're good. Well, I have all kinds of questions related to that. How do we define good? Because different cultures define good in different ways. In certain cultures, it is good not to lose face. Therefore, it is good to be dishonest in certain cultures. In other cultures, it is bad to be dishonest. Honesty reigns at all costs, so just be good. In some cultures and followings, it is good to steal. Whatever you can get without being caught is good. In other cultures, like in ours, it's bad to steal. But it depends on where you are. So first of all, the definition of good and bad. But then there's a bigger issue. Who gets to decide where the scale is? Will you decide? Will I decide? I think I'm good. There, it's settled. That would be great, wouldn't it? We would all pick that for ourselves. Unfortunately, the Word of God teaches that there is an objective measure, Jesus. So we are seen as good or bad in comparison to Jesus. Uh-oh. Because that same book, the Bible, teaches that he's perfect. Uh-oh. If he's perfect and my goodness and badness is stacked up against him, now what do I do? Because I certainly am not Jesus. I thought I was wrong once, but I was mistaken. No, that doesn't fly. I'm wrong a lot. And there's so many things that we try to do to be right. We think, you know what? If you're just sincere, just be sincere. Well, if my wife were here, she'll be in the next service. If she were here, she would share with you very openly that her husband is oftentimes sincerely wrong. I would bet you could say that about your spouse and your family as well. Sincerity is a good thing, but sincerity in and of itself is not enough. How about this? I'll remove all the bad elements from my life. I would refer to that as salvation by subtraction. Well, you won't. You won't remove all of the bad elements from your life. Most of us in the room have lived long enough to know that we won't. And it doesn't matter that we do. That's not the point. The point is not, can I remove enough to be right with God? Or I'll be really good and I'll go to church and I'll give to the needy and I'll do all these nice things. Those are good things to do. I think people ought to do those things. But those things in and of themselves are not enough. They're not enough. If they were enough, Jesus would never have had to die on the cross. But he did. Why? Why? Because we could not do what was necessary to be right with God. Only God could make us right with himself. And he did that by way of the cross. And so often in our world, we want to spell out an understanding of salvation or an understanding of righteousness or an understanding of being good enough. We want to spell that out with this simple word, D-O, do. What do I need to do to be right with God? And I want to suggest to you that what the Bible teaches is a different word. The Bible teaches the word D-O-N-E. what is needed for us to be right with God, what is needed for us to be good enough, has already been done on the cross. Jesus. Now, I got to tell you, for me, I'm so encouraged and relieved that the pressure is off. God's not looking down and saying, come on, Bevel, kick it up a notch. You can do better than that. That's not the God I serve. God looks at me and says, you know, you're broken, but because you have received what I've done on the cross, you are forgiven. Not because of you, but because of what God has done. I'm forgiven. I'm made right. And so the three responses that we have, first of all, the following. Again, if Christ is the way, the truth, and the life, then follow him. Christ has done all that is needed for our salvation. But letter B, there is the understanding. The understanding. Christ is still working on our behalf in heaven at the right hand of the Father. Now, we need to understand that. Oftentimes, we think that God is unplugged from earth, and maybe he'll come back in the future, but right now, it's all on us. We got to figure this out on our own. And we will quote as if it is Scripture, that great verse that says, God helps those who help themselves. That's not a verse. My kids would say, Dad, that's not a thing. It's not in the Bible. That's a made-up philosophy. We can't help ourselves. That's the problem. If we could help ourselves, we wouldn't need God. We can't help ourselves. But the good news is God loves us anyway, and he has provided a way for us. And so we have to understand that even now, God is working on our behalf in order that we might be made right with him for all of eternity. And then last, I want you to see in your response, there is the looking, the looking. I have two illustrations to try to help with this. We have this dog. She's awesome, usually. She's still a puppy. She's only a little over a year old. She's quite large. She's an English pointer. And you go home, you can Google that and see beautiful pictures of English pointers. They're all trained and cool. Ours is cool but not trained, okay? And we love her. Her name is Ladybird. We generally refer to her as Birdie. Birdie is a pointer by birth. There is something in her bloodline that causes her to point. One paw up, tail straight out. It's the most beautiful thing you could ever imagine when you see it. We have a high part in our backyard over our pool, and she will sometimes stand on that high part of our patio and point. One time I timed her, she pointed for 4 minutes without moving. Did not even blink. She's white with brown spots. She's quite a specimen. She's looking at everything at the same time. I went out one time to see. I quietly walked behind her. I wanted to see, what is she looking at? I got down on a knee and I looked. It was a butterfly over by the hedge, probably 15 feet away, and it was doing what butterflies do, and she was going to get it. It might be a lizard. Occasionally it's a frog. When it's another dog, oh boy, it gets really crazy at that point. But what I see in her is a constant desire to look. She's always looking because something exciting is about to happen in her world. The looking is the way that God calls us as Christ followers, if in fact you are, to live our lives. We're not to live with doubt. We're not to live with disappointment. We're not to live with frustration. We're to live with great joy, looking for that day when he will return. Is it today? Maybe it's today. Waking up in the morning going, you know what? Jesus might come back today. I have a really tough day, but Jesus might come back today. I'm going to move through my day just as I need to and have to, but I'm going to move through the difficulties of this day with great expectation, great anticipation that maybe today, because the Bible says he will come like a thief in the night when you least expect it. Three of our four children are grown and leaving. They're in college. One's grown and married. The two are in college. One's still at home. But of the three that have pretty much gone and moved on their way via college or married life, living in different states, all three of them. They fly home occasionally. And because of Thanksgiving and the holidays, we've seen them a lot over the last few weeks. And I've made a lot of airport runs. And one of my greatest joys, I always park when I go to the airport. I go early, I walk in, and I wait. Because I want to see them walking down the hall. I love that. I sit there, usually stand there, waiting. And I know they've landed because they've already texted me, "Dad, we're on the ground." And I start looking with all the people coming around the corner. Are they in this bunch? I'll sometimes, "Which flight were you on? Did you come from this city or that city?" They'll tell me. I go, "Great, okay, I got the right flight now." And then I think they must have been on the last seat because they're not coming. They're not coming. And I had this anticipation, like, I really hope they made it. They sent me a text and said, and then boom, they come around the corner. It's awesome. For those of you with little children, you're thinking, when does that day come? It comes. And when it comes, it doesn't seem so great at that point. But let me tell you that there is that anticipation and that joy. That's how God has called us to live our lives. And we can live that way because we can know with certainty, based on the Word of God, that He will come again. And when He does, He will clean house in a good way. He will do what only God can do. He will make a way where there is no way. He will provide hope, a future, direction. But here's the thing, He's doing that now. He has provided a way through the cross. He came as this little baby. We celebrate His birthday because we acknowledge the incredible miracle of the incarnation of God. So here's my question for you on this Christmas Eve 2016. Do you believe Jesus, the Christ, the Son of God, the baby in the manger, the sacrificed Savior on the cross, the reigning King of Kings, Lord of Lords, who will return in all His glory and split the eastern sky? Do you believe that He is the way, the truth, and the life? If you do, then the greatest thing you can acknowledge this Christmas is that truth. And if you do not yet hold to that truth, please hear these words of mine. It is true. It is true. And Jesus is the greatest gift of all. I implore you, I plead with you, receive Him as the forgiver of your sin and the leader of your life. He is glad to take up residence in your life today. Let's pray together. Lord God, I ask that You would open wide the eyes of our hearts to see You. For those of us here today who know You as Lord and Savior, we've come simply on this special weekend to celebrate You anew and afresh. We know these truths. We know that You have gloriously saved us, though we do not deserve it. There's nothing in us that deserves Your salvation and being made right with You, but You've done so anyway. Your Word says, and that while we were yet sinners, You died for us. Thank You. We acknowledge that. We rejoice in that. We marvel that You have chosen us for forgiveness, to be adopted into Your family. Can't understand it. We simply say thank You. There are others here, Lord, who do not yet know You. They have not yet received this grace, this gift of life that only You can give. They have not yet received the forgiveness that is theirs simply for the asking because of what You've done on the cross. And so I pray that spiritually speaking, they would come to know You. That as You stated in John chapter 3, as You were speaking to one of Your servants, You said that people must be born again. The reference there, Lord, is, I'm certain, to spiritual birth, not physical birth, for we've already been born physically. But spiritually speaking, to be born anew, to be born again, receiving You as Lord and Savior, being adopted into Your family. I pray for anyone who has not yet done that, that You would open the eyes of their heart to see You and to receive You this very moment. And then, Lord, I pray for those who know you, but there is a struggle. There is a war going on inside them. Your word teaches that those days will come. It's a spiritual battle even to live. It takes all day just to live. And so, Lord, I pray for your peace, a peace that passes all understanding and comprehension. That the war could be for many different reasons. It could be personal struggles that are taking place, relational issues that are happening, financial catastrophe, a diagnosis may have just been received. Any number of things could be taking place right now in their lives, Lord, and it would cause them maybe to doubt and to struggle. I ask, Lord, that you would meet them at that point right now and encourage them in their walk with you. Thank you for doing it in Jesus' name. Amen. It is our custom in most of our worship services, as we come to the end of our teaching time, which is focused us in on God's Word and God's Spirit, that we would consider personally what we will do with the truths that we have heard. And so I want to give that opportunity here this afternoon as well, that you might, before leaving, I would just ask that you all stick around. If we would just reflect and consider these things that we've been listening to, the Word of God that's been read, now what? Now what? What is it that God has for me? He's brought you to this place tonight, this church tonight. He's brought you with maybe the people who are sitting around you, family or friends that you're here with. Maybe there is a big decision on the horizon for you and you know it. Maybe there's a big decision on the horizon for you and you don't yet know it. But God does. Use this time as a time of prayer, time of consideration. I'll be here immediately after our time of worship. If you have questions, it would be my joy to talk with you. We have a gap in between the services, so I'd be glad to speak with you and try to answer any questions you may have. But as we sing together, just consider what it is that God would have you do next. Would you stand, please, and join us as we sing together? The front is open if you'd like to come and
shine brighter and light.
be the end of our service after that song. But before we sing this wonderful, beautiful Christmas song, I just want to read these words, what the angel said to the shepherds. The angel said to them, "Fear not, for behold, I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord." I pray that this will be a very merry Christmas for you. I pray that 2017 will be a very blessed year for you if the Lord allows the world to stand. I pray you would return back to our church if this is not your church home and you live in the area. We would love to be your home for discovering the way, the truth, the life, who is Jesus. Thank you so much for being here today. Sing this song with us and have a very Merry Christmas.
Christmas, everyone.